Hello, everybody. Hello, Manchester, I should say. Hey, fantastic. Hello, everybody. You're being zoomed into the Manchester Buddhist Centre Shrine Room. And I think we've got an audience of about 40 here in the room. So hello, Manchester, wave. Hey! And how many people we got online there? Sangadara?
About 60, but people are just joining.
Brilliant. And we've also got, don't know if you can see them yet, but there's a retreat going on in Germany at Vimaladhatu. There's an ordination retreat. So there's 25 people on a What is the Order retreat, and they're all beaming in as part of their retreat experience. So that's fantastic. Let's say hello to them. Hello, Vimaladhatu in Germany. Fantastic. Yeah. And we've also got some very generous interpreters. So the talks are going to be interpreted in German and Spanish. Yeah. So we're delighted today to make the International Women's Day all about the uniqueness of Triratna and the fact that we have had for 56 years now equal ordination for men and women. And we're going to be talking about how that has been over these 56 years for the women's wing, and also in relation to going on retreat and retreat centres over that time. So we've got some really great speakers, both here and online. We've got one star guest online. So that's really exciting. I think that's going to be a really great afternoon. And I'm really delighted to be doing this with Subhadramati, who was here yesterday. She led a beautiful night last night for us here, and really demonstrated to me anyway a lot of the qualities I really admire in her, which is her joyfulness and exuberance and wisdom in encouraging women, encouraging people on the path, on their spiritual path, wherever they are, whatever they need. Just really, really generous. It was a fantastic evening last night. And I just wanted to say a little bit about Subhadramati for those of you who don't know her. She came along to the movement in her early 20s in London, and she spent many years working in many different right livelihood contexts, living in two right livelihood contexts, but living in lots of communities, both in London and in Dublin. And she was Mitra Convener at London Buddhist Centre, looking after a lot of women there for 14 years. And then just recently, she's moved to the country, and she's living at Tiratanaloka at our retreat centre down in the Brecon Beacons, and she'll be talking about that later. But we're really delighted to have her here, and she's holding today. So I'm going to pass the mic, hopefully successfully, over to her. But let's give her a round of applause and welcome her.
Great. Thank you very much, Karen Tara, for a very generous introduction. And yeah, lovely to be here. Lovely to be here in Manchester. Warm welcome from me to everyone who's here today. And really warm welcome to everyone who's tuning in on Zoom, especially the whole retreat full in Germany, as we heard, and also people who are going to be watching this in the future on YouTube. So that's really good. So, yes, so I'm just going to say a little bit to introduce the afternoon a bit further, and then we're going to hear from some other people. So, yes, as Karunatara indicated, the Triratna Buddhist Order, of which we're part, was founded a good number of years ago, in 1968, in fact, by Bhante Sangharakshita, our founder and teacher, and it's now grown to be a worldwide Buddhist order and movement. And the really wonderful thing, one of the wonderful things about it is, right from the beginning, as Karen Natara said, there was equal ordination for women. In fact, the very first person to be ordained into our order was a woman. And that actually is very, very innovative thing. It actually, at the time, made the British newspapers. It was such a thing that a woman could be ordained equally. The ordination itself is equal, and the, I don't want to say status, it's not quite the right word, but it's of equal standing. Women order members are of equal standing. That was quite innovative, actually. And that's what we're celebrating today. And I want to say a few words to just trace the origins of that, how that came to be. And then we're going to hear from our speakers. And then there'll also be today the opportunity to help this living tradition to just keep thriving and flourishing. So here we go. So I'm actually going to start not all those years ago, but I'm actually going to start with something quite recent, relatively recent. In 2018, 50 years after he founded our order, Bhante Sangharakshita died. Many of us were there at his funeral at Adishtana, our retreat centre in Hereford. Some of you might have seen pictures. And what I'm going to draw attention to is Bhante's coffin. So his coffin, which is now under the ground at Adishtana, was made of cardboard, and it was painted sky blue with a cloud from which rain was falling and loads of plants and flowers growing up. And now that's very, very significant. So it's not just that, it wasn't just painted like that because that's a nice pretty picture, which it was as well. But actually, that was depicting an ancient Buddhist teaching, an ancient text called the Parable of the Rain Cloud, which is a teaching from the White Lotus Sutra. And that was one of Bhante Sangharakshita's most cherished teachings, actually. So the imagery of that is this cloud raining down rain. The imagery is the joy when the rainy season starts after a long period of drought, when the rains come. It's a symbol of life and growth. Everything then comes to life because of that rain. And it parallels the Buddhist vision, which is that every living thing is growing. Every living thing sort of wants to grow, wants to unfold like a plant, wants to reach its full potential, wants to keep reaching sort of onwards and outwards. So that's the first bit of the symbolism. There's another meaning as well. The rain, just like the sun as well, is impartial. So the rain just, you know, falls on everything. It doesn't kind of rain a bit here, but withhold the rain here. It just rains. The Buddhist word for that impartiality is ekarasa, one taste. So the rain falls on all alike, all the plants alike. But each plant grows according to its own nature. Yeah, so each plant grows according to its own nature. And again, that's the same with beings when they encounter the Dharma, the vision of truth, and allow themselves to be sort of saturated by that vision of truth and permeated by it. Everyone grows according to their own nature. At the same time, everyone sort of becomes equally more alive. So that's what that painted coffin was symbolizing, this sort of cherished vision of Bhante Sangharakshita, the founder and teacher. So going now back in time again to Bhante's early life, he realized he was a Buddhist when he was 16. He was born in London, realized he was a Buddhist at 16. In his early 20s, he found himself in India seeking ordination. And I've recently been rereading his memoirs. The very, very striking passage when he is in his early 20s trying to get ordained himself, which wasn't easy. But he came across one monastery, and there was a group of women there, and they were very, very sincere. They were all practicing the 10 precepts. They were all studying the Dharma, but they could never become ordained. And that was because the tradition had died out wherein they could become ordained. And what they mainly did, apart from studying the Dharma, was they cooked and swept for the monks. Yeah, so that's what they did. And one of them, particularly Mother Vipassana, she was the oldest of the women. She and Bhante, who's only like 22 at the time, formed a very deep and special connection. So already, right back then, before the Triratna Buddhist order was even a twinkle in anyone's eye, there's already intimations that this state of affairs, where women could never be ordained, was the opposite of what Bhante believed. If you think of that parable, everything can grow and flourish according to its own nature, every being. So Bhante really didn't believe in that sort of artificial hierarchy, to call it that, where some people could get ordained and some people couldn't get ordained. And then by the time of his founding Triratna, he realized what he did believe, and what he did believe was the primary thing was what we call going for refuge to the three jewels, the Buddha, the ideal of enlightenment, the Dharma, the teachings, the truth itself, the Sangha, the spiritual community, commitment to those three. That's what makes you a Buddhist. That's what Bhante realized. So the Buddha shows us a vision of truth, and this vision is so great that sort of all you can do is kind of give yourself completely to it. And ordination is that act of giving yourself completely to it. What Bhante realized is ordination, it doesn't mean joining anything, like joining a society or something. The order, to the Triratna order, is an order, not a society. So, putting these two things together, so because of this principle of life and growth, that all beings have that potential, and because going for refuge, that commitment, is primary, then it was natural when Bhante founded the order that of course women could be ordained. There was no question about it. It wasn't, even a question of trying to equalize things, or not a sort of socio-political matter. It was completely natural. Of course women could be ordained as well. And of course their ordination would be completely equal to anyone else's. That's what follows naturally. So in a way, as I say, it's not political, it's not a representation, it's not, oh, let's even things out here. It's something much simpler, but in fact, much deeper than that. And we are the fruits of that. I'm a fruit of that. Karen Tara is a fruit of that. The speakers we're going to hear are fruits of that. And the whole order, actually, not just the women, is a fruit of that, because actually it's got loads of other implications. So that's a little outline of the principles. And now what we're going to hear with our speakers is, well, how has that worked out in practice? Yeah, so it's all very well to have principles, but how has that actually worked out in practice? How has it been worked out in the last 55 years? And how is it going to be, how's it going to be continued to be worked out in the future? So I realize I've probably been speaking far too fast for the translators. Oops, I'm sorry about that. The first speaker we're going to hear from is Dayanandi. So Dayanandi's been a member of our order since 1986. And she herself has conducted many ordinations in the UK and in North America as well. And why we've asked Dayanandi to speak to us, particularly today, is she was one of the founding members of a retreat center, which is still running and flourishing very much so, called Taraloka, which, as far as we know, was the first Buddhist retreat center for women in the world. So let's welcome Dayanandi.
Is that all right? I think so. How can you hear me okay? I could have a bit nearer. Even better. Yeah, lovely to see everybody, and thank you, Subhadramati. That was a really inspiring introduction. Really lovely. So I'm going to talk quite personally, actually, about what it was like to help build Taraloka, which was, as Subhadramati said, the first women's retreat center in Triratna. But not only that, as it turned out, we were, I think, the first retreat center for women, built by women, taught by women, That's really, really unique. Often women were taught by men in the tradition. Okay, I'll plunge in. So, speaking personally then, so I met the Dharma at the age of 25 in 1979 in London at the London Buddhist Centre, as it had only just opened actually. I was working as an architect at that time. I must remember to speak slowly for the translators. Yeah, and when I came across Buddhism in the form of meditation initially, I just fell in love with it initially. It just felt quite natural to me. I don't know, somehow it just sort of felt like it had a place in my heart, and it was how I wanted to live my life. It just felt like the natural way to live. And yes, yeah, so quite soon I was going on some retreats, and that they had a very, very positive impact on me. So I'm not sure if everybody here will have been on retreat or not, but in a Buddhist retreat, it's an opportunity to go out into the country, usually into nature. And in a way, in a sense, you're just getting away from everything, getting away from your life. We didn't have mobile phones then. Things were simpler. Nowadays, you turn your mobile phone off. As I gradually, deepened my meditation and came to understand the Dharma a bit more, I felt like I was not only finding the Dharma, but I was finding myself. Came to love meditation in a way, for it gave me access to myself at a much deeper way than I'd ever realized could be possible. Very, very, very exciting. But it didn't occur to me at that time at all that I could possibly ever live at a women's retreat center. Partly because there wasn't one. There wasn't any retreat center for women to go to. So my early retreats were in converted youth hostels or sort of big boarding schools in sort of large grounds. And the team of women who went to set those up would have to take everything. So we would have the Buddha, we'd have bits for the shrine, we'd have mats and cushions, we'd have all the food. It was an enormous amount of work to set up a retreat in those days. And if you could imagine a school, I can remember once there was this great big hall where we ate, and it had rows of portraits of the headmasters sort of sternly looking down, and you couldn't get them off the wall. So they had to hang cloths over all these portraits. And so there's a lot of work to do to set a retreat up. And then at the end, it took a while to build the atmosphere up. I suppose that was one of the big things, that you felt like you were having to go against something to create an atmosphere. And then at the end, you just lost it all. You took it all down, took it all home. And next time you were going somewhere else, and there was a lot of work again. And I was very, very aware that we weren't building anything up as women, actually. It wasn't a collective heart to our collective, our community as women practitioners. I felt a lot of energy was being lost, really. We weren't able to deepen and build an atmosphere together. And it felt like we weren't able to sort of gather our own stories or our own myth together either. It was like everything was just diffusing away all the time. Anyway, moving on to 1984, that was, I'd left my job as an architect. I don't know if I mentioned I was an architect at that time. I left my job to work with other Buddhists because I really felt, I actually felt I needed to become more a human being, even if I wasn't to continue being an architect. I just didn't feel human enough, and working with other Buddhists, it felt like that would be a way to really transform myself. And I worked in a Whole Food Right Livelihood in West London. And one day in West London came to our center three women who were introducing the vision of a new retreat center for women, and they came to fundraise for it. And I was very, very inspired listening to it, really, really inspired, got very fired up. And I remember confiding to a friend on the way to work the next day that actually I wish I could live there. I actually would be quite interested in living there, but never occurred to me that I could, that I thought there'd be like queues of people wanting to do that. And she said, oh, I don't know, maybe there aren't. Why don't you ask and find out? And as it turned out, as it turned out in 1986, I moved there. So I got ordained in 1986, as Subhadramati said. And straight after my ordination retreat, I was going up to what was now called Taraloka, the women's retreat center. And it was in converted farm buildings in, it's North Shropshire, on the borders with Clwyd. Very, very sort of flat, marshy sort of land, actually. It didn't look like my idea of a retreat centre initially, I have to say. But to backtrack slightly to my ordination retreat, on the retreat, Sangadevi, who was the founder and the leader of the project, she was on my ordination retreat, and she took me aside one day and said to me quite sternly, well, don't think when you're coming to Taraloka that you're going to be meditating all the time and on meditation retreats. You have to do what's needed. And that might be putting out the bins, and it might be this, it might be that. So I thought, oh yes, of course, Sangadevi, I was very inspired, and it didn't, you know, felt. So they were building Taraloka, and it was all hands on deck, really. There was a lot of work to be done, but I was obviously very welcome with my architectural background. That was very handy. So I arrived in August after my retreat, after my ordination, and I was on a bit of a cloud actually at that point, very inspired, and I felt like I was, nothing could stop me. I was so sort of inspired by that. I found a long whitewashed community house in a sort of livable sort of condition, and then a set of semi-derelict barns, which were red brick barns, which were being in process of being converted to create the retreat centre. To a very basic level for the first retreats, which were about to happen in 2 weeks' time. So very, very basic level. They would have been like just chipboard floors, foam mattresses on the chipboard, no paint on the walls, shrine made of boxes. It was that sort of level, and no dining room and no lounge. So everything was eating outside. But we got a retreat centre, and that was the beginning. But there was mud everywhere, barbed wire, concrete blocks, corrugated iron. No garden. The retreat centre was, you couldn't imagine it if you've been there recently. And I thought, where have I landed? So there was nothing cosy or feminine about the place at all. Women were just working very, very hard, and they were very, very tired. They'd been working, some of them, 9 months to get to that point, and doing a lot of the physical labour. We had builders to do the more skilled things, and the Buin didn't have the like plumbing or whatever, electrics, but the women had done a lot of like drilling out the concrete on the shrine room had been completely drilled out to lower the floor, and women had done all of that and carted all the concrete out, and very, very hard labour. So I was very impressed to see what was happening there. I think I'm probably going too fast, but anyway. So I first arrived, and I was it was sunny. I remember sitting outside and writing a talk for the first retreat, which I got asked to give a talk on my ordination retreat, on the first retreat I was going to be on at Taraloka. But anyway, I was doing that. But shortly after that retreat, which was lovely and sunny, I remember, Sangadevi and a couple of the other founder members said, well, we're really tired now, you take over, we're going off for a break. And they said, they asked me if I would lead a small building team. We had to convert the dining room, which was the next chunk of barn along that hadn't been converted yet, to make a dining room for the winter retreats, which were happening in 3.5 months time. And if we didn't have those winter retreats, we just needed the money. We had to have the income, and so it had to happen. And so I was with this rather dysfunctional, to have to be said, team. We had to do the roof. We were cutting out, trimming down slates and cutting out rafters, putting in roof lights, had to lay a dampproof course, concrete floor, put in windows, plasterboard, electrics, the lot. And there were about 3 or 4 of us doing it. And one of the things about me was that I'd never done any building work, although I think they were glad to have an architect, but it's different sort of drawing this line, which is your damp proof course, on a drawing, neatly drawing it, tucking into the brickwork. And then there I was with a couple of other people manhandling this really cumbersome, thick plastic damp proof course and trying to get it to sort of stay flat and then go up into this brickwork and these grooves. And it was like my standards dropped very quickly. So it was challenging. I was very nerve-wracked a lot of the time. In many ways, our Bible was the Reader's Digest book of home repairs. And also, we did get a lot of help from some local builders who were really kind, a couple of brothers who did a lot of the work for us, at bits and pieces of, you know, brickwork or more skilled work. One of the highlights of my building work, actually, a few years later, I learned how to do lead flashings around chimneys from these particular builders. And if you ever go to Taraloka, it's a very beautiful lead flashing that is still there on the chimney above the lounge. And I have to say that none of the roofs have leaked. We put in roof lights and we did all the flashings and everything like that. Doing the electrics was a very undesirable and hairy thing to do. The woman who was an electrician and carpenter was working on this project, but she had to leave, and she showed me very briefly the circuit for the electrics in the dining room and how to wire up a light switch and a socket. And I actually had to do the whole thing, and it was, you know, actually plasterboarding in the electric sockets, the lighting, and thinking, I hope it works. Don't have to take the whole ceiling down. Anyway, so the dining room at Taraloka was wired by me. The storage heaters were my lowest point, but luckily they took them out later and put in a central heating. I was quite relieved when they did that. But everything, it did work, but it was a challenge, I have to say, doing all of that. Basically, we were sort of saving every penny, actually, for building work. So we lived very, very frugally. That was one of the things about being there. We couldn't afford things like cheese and eggs and tofu. We seemed to live on ground sunflower seeds, and I guess there must have been beans. I can't quite remember. And the story goes that the founder members, before I got there, they were living, Ratna Shuri, who was wonderful, she's in her 60s when I moved there, wonderful woman. And the other, everyone else was in their early 30s, but Ratna Shuri was very heroically came in her 60s. But she had a pension, and she shared her pension with the other three. And that was their pocket money for the first few months. It's very kind of her to do that, and it's very famous, but they'd stopped doing that by the time I got there. We got bed and board and a little bit of pocket money, and we weren't expected to go out anyway because there was nowhere to go, really. We had one car between us all, and the idea was we were a retreat community. We had no TV. It was all very, very sort of, you know, right on retreat center. So it was quite frugal and quite challenging, and I was lonely. I think that was one of the things I hadn't really thought about. I was very, really inspired to go to Taraloka, but I knew nobody there, and everyone really pioneering and sort of go-getting, and at the end of the workday, they would just go back to their rooms and prepare the next day's work, probably. So I was sort of a bit lonely, really, and a friend came on retreat a few weeks later and a few months later, asked me, well, was I happy there? And in a way, I wasn't happy. But in another way, when she asked me, it was a good question, actually, and I realized actually I was really deeply happy, very deeply happy. And we're quite moved, actually. It was because I could be myself there, and people really just didn't expect me to be, what was it? There was no expectations of me other than that I would just be who I was, and I would rise to things. And it was very, very encouraging and confidence building environment to be in. Could just be anything, as it were. Yes. It was tough in some ways to have to put aside preferences, and I had to let go of wanting to be on meditation retreats or to train up to lead meditation retreats, because that wasn't needed, and I was needed to go on the more collective summer and winter retreats and learn to write talks and lead groups. And initially I found that quite difficult, but because I was pretty shy and introverted. But actually I realized I really enjoyed it, and I actually gained a new confidence in myself in a different way from doing something I wouldn't have chosen to do. I realized actually rather I liked being with people on retreats. It was great. What kept us going through the difficulties, I think it was the vision, a very, very strong vision that everybody shared, and we could sort of see what a difference we were making. I think there was a great excitement to be creating a women's retreat center, and a lot of support and encouragement coming from the women who came on the retreats. Very satisfying to see the project developing as well. Yeah, feeling we are making a real contribution. You can really sort of see that and feel that. Yeah, and it had a very, very positive exponential effect, I think, on the growth of women in the movement. Mm-hmm. Suddenly, from there being maybe 3 or 4 retreats a year that women could go on, there was a retreat that nearly every week. So there was a space for so many different types of retreats. And people could go on more than one retreat, several retreats, come and live and go on a whole succession of retreats. And I think women's spiritual practice deepened, and the ordination process retreats all happened there as well at that point. So it was like a real, explosion of vitality and confidence for women when we got that going. And I think also the fact that women, we couldn't fall back on men, there weren't men to fall back on. And in those days, it was the 80s, early 90s, and traditionally, it was still quite a traditional society. Women, men did tend, and still do tend to be the ones who do the car, don't they, and do the DIY. Things haven't changed as much as you would have thought. But at Taraloka, we didn't have that. We realized that we could do far more than we would have imagined. And I suppose lastly, contrasting to, you know, going to a youth hostel or a school and setting it up and losing all that energy, at Taraloka, what we were doing was an energy and an atmosphere was building all the time. We never lost anything. Mm-hmm. So every bit of inspiration and the memories that came from the retreats, they were all embedded in the fabric of Taraloka. Mm-hmm. Women would come back from on another retreat and they would say, gosh, being back here, it just reminds me, it takes me back to that other retreat I was on, because I remember I was walking down sitting on that bench there, and I thought such and such, and it was a bit like myths and stories had their place, and Taraloka was holding such a lot. And it was also, I think, when even women who couldn't come on retreat knew it was there, and that seemed to make a difference too. So yeah, it was an enormous transformative thing. And I suppose Subhadramati said, what would I wish for the future for women in Buddhism? And I would wish for more places like Taraloka. Actually, it's only the one in the UK. It could be more in other countries. I'll just slow down for the translators for Germany and Spain and Mexico. Yeah, more retreat centers for women, built by women, giving women the opportunity for that sort of pioneering life and lived with each other. Because now I think my deepest, strongest friendships are with the people I built Taraloka with and lived with there. I was there for 16 years in the end, and and sort of going back now and seeing it, it's just, as many of you all know, it's very, very beautiful, very, very lush, no question of sort of windswept, sparse landscapes. It's absolutely gorgeous, and everything built with such care. So it's a credit to everybody. It keeps on developing, actually. It doesn't stop. It keeps on developing, which is very inspiring. Yeah. So anyway, thanks for hearing that.
Oh, thank you very, very much indeed, Dayanandi. That, like, loads of what you said, I was hearing for the first time as well. It's so important to, you know, have these like stories of, just stories told and retold, and your inspiration just really comes across and shines through. That's really wonderful. Thank you. So, our next speaker is Dhammadinna. And Dhammadinna was ordained in 1973. And she's going to be joining us via Zoom. So we're going to be seeing Dhammadinna on the screen in a moment. And she is joining us from London, from her community, Somayakula, where she lives with 11 other women of all ages, right from their 20s up to their 70s. I won't tell you where Dhammadinna falls on that spectrum. Dhammadinna is one of our senior most order members. She's really properly one of our elders. She's conducted many ordinations, countless ordinations of other women. And Dhammadinna, I am particularly delighted to have Dhammadinna with us today because she was a founding member of Tiratanaloka Retreat Centre, which was our first, is our first ordination training centre for women in Triratna and actually maybe in the world, who knows, probably. So let's really welcome Dhammadinna.
Thank you, Subhadramati. Subhadramati suggested to me that I talk about what inspired the Tiratanaloka project, what difficulties and hardships we had along the way, what impact it's had on our community, Triratna community, and what thoughts or wishes I might have for the future. So we found what became Tiratanaloka in the late summer, early autumn of 1994. And we bought it, we moved in, it did a lot of work, and so we could have our first retreat there in the autumn of 1994. But it had taken us 5 years to get to that point, so there was quite a lot of hardships along the way. It's great to hear Dayanandi talk about Taraloka. I think actually I led the first retreat at Taraloka in the autumn of 1985, which was in the house because, as Dayanandi said, there was no retreat centre then there. So that's 9 years before the Tiratanaloka first retreat. And also, just to talk about Taraloka a little bit, as Dayanandi said, it runs retreats for any woman who wants to go on retreat. But from quite early on there, they hosted pre-ordination retreats, ordination training retreats for women. And these were run by a voluntary team who had come in and run those retreats and were sometimes attended by Sangharakshita, our founder and teacher. And I think it's important to just remember what those retreats were like. They were selection retreats. They were invitation retreats. So the team would invite women who they thought might be ready for ordination that year on a 1 month retreat in the spring. And then they'd select some of those women to go on a 2 week retreat in the summer, and then they'd select some of those women who they thought were ready for ordination to go on an ordination retreat in the autumn, which would be led by Sangharakshita. So that was a good project. It meant more women got ordained. But if you didn't get ordained, if you didn't get selected, of course, it was a painful experience. And I wasn't on those retreats. I was doing a course at the time, but I did live at the London Buddhist Centre where I live now and in the community. So some of my Mitra friends would come back and they'd be ordained, and that was wonderful. And some of them would come back and they'd not been selected for the next retreat, or they'd not been ordained that year. And I knew from firsthand experience that that was a difficult experience for them, quite painful. And also the team were a voluntary team, and they couldn't provide any support or backup between retreats. It wasn't possible for them. So when I finished my course, I was invited to go on the spring retreat, the month retreat in 1990, to be part of the team. So that was a great retreat, great to be on retreat for a month. And the people on the team I knew very well. And it didn't take us very long to think, oh, we need to do things differently. This is good, but it's not working for everyone. So we realized that we needed to create an ongoing ordination training for women, where we could provide consistency and backup with a permanent team. And we thought, we wondered whether we would use Taraloka for that, where we'd change Taraloka into an ordination training retreat centre. But Taraloka is just great as it is. And so we decided quite quickly that we needed to find our own retreat centre and set up this ordination training process. So that was quite a big decision. And those of us who thought we were going to take that forward, so that was myself, Anjali, Samatar and Anomar, supported by our public preceptors, we decided that we would need to free ourselves up to live together and then fundraise and property search by the spring of 1992. So that's what we did. We moved together, we rented a house near Taraloka with Sangadevi, who joined us, and then we could start that project in earnest, as it were. It's probably quite hard for many of you to imagine that we were property searching and fundraising before the internet. There was a world, there was life before the internet, and even mobile phones. So that was one of our first challenges, you know, looking back. We had a small community, five of us, and we had one landline between five of us for personal and, you know, the business of fundraising and property searching. There was a phone box on the corner where you could pop down and phone your boyfriend if you needed to. So no landline, no mobile phones, no internet. And I think we had one very old computer that was mine, another old computer and a printer. So that was a challenge. And I think these days people property search online, don't they? That's how you do it. But in those days, what we had to do was to go to estate agents and say what we wanted. And then we had paper property speculation. So our little community was full of boxes full of paper property speculation, which we had to read. We had to assess them, see if they would be in any way suitable, and decide whether we would go and view them or not. And viewing them meant getting into a little car and driving all over the country and looking at different properties. So we were running retreats still, 92, 93, 94. We were still running a series of retreats. We were fundraising, we were property searching. So it was quite a full-on life. And I think in some ways we were probably a bit mad, but I think we were mad in a good way. I'm glad that we were mad in a good way. One challenge was doing all that. Another challenge was that we didn't have any money. So we decided to move together and start fundraising as well as property searching. And Samato, who in a way was our main fundraiser, she's a brilliant fundraiser, she moved to Taraloka in the summer of 1991. So Taraloka, all the way through our project, were very, very supportive. And I remember our excitement and her excitement when she got her first £20 check. So yeah, we started with nothing. We started with no money and we worked up from there. So I think a challenge when you are property searching, however you do it, is if you go and view a property, you kind of have to imagine that you're living there in your mind's eye, in your imagination. So we would go and look at a property and we'd have to think, could we live here as a retreat centre? We'd have to imagine ourselves doing that. So where would the shrine room be? How many bedrooms would there be? How many people could we sleep? Where would the dining room be? Where would the lounge be? Were there enough spaces for study rooms? How much land did it have? Would there be room for expansion? So you do that and you engage with that very, very fully. And then we might put an offer in on a place and then that would be refused, not accepted. Or we might realise that the property wasn't suitable once we'd really looked at it. And then there's just this strong sense of disappointment because you've kind of, in your mind, you've lived in this place and you're already running a retreat centre. So that's one of the challenges that I remember very vividly, that sense of disappointment and then the need to, you know, pull yourself together, as it were, and start all over again and start looking again for properties. Going back to the challenge of not having very much money, we were determined, once we started fundraising, that we would only use money from the fundraising and from the retreat income, enough money to just pay our rent in this little house, to pay our bills and food, and then we had £10 pocket money a week, so really not very much. And in some ways, looking back, I think, well, was that a hardship or not? In some ways, obviously it was. You couldn't do much on £10 a week even then. Now, it won't even buy you a burger, will it? A vegetarian burger. But I think everybody was fundraising for us. We had such a lot of support across the whole community, really. And people were very generous. So I felt it was a hardship. But on the other hand, you know, I just felt we felt inspired by the support we were given. And sometimes people would send us food parcels, which was very welcome. And I remember Anjali, who was one of our founder members, who died sadly a few years ago. She would do our community shop. And I remember her coming home and she would be very excited and pleased if she managed to find us a little treat that was on special, you know, special offer. Very sweet of her. So yeah, some of those challenges, money and property searching. So then in, I think it was the summer of 1994, so we'd been doing this for a few years, we had three properties in our sights. And I think we were convinced that one of them would be the place that we were going to end up in for our retreat centre. And I remember we were on our way to an ordination action. I remember Samatar popping into a phone box and ringing the estate agent and discovering that we'd lost all three properties. We'd been outbid. And I remember that sense of disappointment. I think it was not just disappointment. I think we felt devastated because we'd been looking for so long and 2.5 years, nearly 3 years, and we knew we were going to have to start all over again. But luckily, out of nowhere, as it were, an order friend of ours, a man order member who was a friend of ours, told us that his father was caretaking a property in the Brecon Beacons for a bank that used to be a hotel because it was in receivership with the bank. So we set off, we looked at Tiratanaloka, we decided to buy it. And as I said, we started our first retreat in the late autumn that year, 1994. So we were fortunate, it didn't need a lot of work. We could sort of start quite quickly. And then I guess the challenge was running a retreat centre. Apart from Sangha Devi, who lived with us at the time, who'd lived at Taraloka for a long time, none of us had done that. So, you know, you've got a building you're not used to, you have all the management of the building and everything that goes with that. You're trying to set up a retreat program. You're trying to decide what you're going to do on the retreats. You're preparing the material. You're doing running the bookings, you know, getting people to come on retreat, doing all the bookings. And it was a very small team. It was about, I think there were six of us and one of them was part-time. So yeah, that was very challenging in many ways, those early days. At the same time, I think we were just so pleased to be somewhere and to start running those retreats. Yeah, so I guess our inspiration in setting all that up was to provide something that was stress-free for women so that they could be on as many retreats as possible. Just come on retreat, deepen their practice, understand Triratna more fully, befriend the people on the team. We could befriend those women and keep up with them between retreats. And then, you know, ordination would kind of happen down the line quite naturally without there having to be this kind of invite selection process. So a later challenge, once we were set up and running, was that I guess the project was successful, as it were. It was effective in that more women got ordained. That certainly happened. And then more women came on retreat and more women asked for ordination. So the number of women who wanted to come on our retreats, it just expanded quite quickly. We think, well, how are we going to cope with that? Because Tiratanaloka was not big in the beginning. It's a lovely place. It's a beautiful property, and it's in a national park. It's very beautiful if you've been there. But being in a national park means you've got great restrictions on building regulations. You can't really expand that much, and it didn't have a lot of land. So even from the beginning, it was smallish. We had looked at bigger and cheaper properties in our, you know, massive property search around the country, but often we decided not to pursue those because they were very dilapidated and they might have a big hole in the ceiling or be very, very damp. And we had a builder friend who, a man order member, who said to us on one occasion, look, don't buy an old wreck, you'll just be throwing money at it forever. So when we came across Tiratanaloka, it seemed like a very good buy, and it's been, you know, a wonderful place for so many years. But yeah, had limitations of size. And at the time, when the number of women wanting to come on retreat expanded so much, we met those challenges in various ways. So we just squashed more women into the retreat centre. That's one thing we did. We asked Taraloka if they would take on some what we called going for refuge retreats, the ordination training retreats for us. So they've always been very supportive and generous to our project. we decided to expand the support team, which meant we bought a house in a nearby village so that we could have a bigger team. And then we expanded our ordination team so that we could divide into two teams so that we could run retreats back to back throughout the whole year. So we did respond to those challenges as creatively as possible. And in a way, it's a good challenge, wasn't it? There were more women wanting to come on retreat and more women getting ordained. And that kind of fulfilled our vision and our inspiration. Sangharakshita was always very, very supportive of this project, as he was of Taraloka as well. And he came to visit us regularly, maybe once or twice a year. And he'd be with us, be with the team. He'd do study with us and talk over the project and just help us in lots of different ways. So we felt very much that we had his support. But quite early on, I think a few years into the Tiratanaloka project, he came to visit us and he suggested that we try and run longer ordination retreats for women. So at that time, we were just running a 2-week retreat in the summer at Tiratanaloka. And he had a vision to run longer ordination retreats abroad, so somewhere quite remote, so that people had a definite sense of being out of the world, away from the world, and they could focus on their practice and becoming ordained and absorbing that experience over, he hoped, 3 months, 4 months. So we still only had quite a small team and we still had a lot to do, but we did manage to hire a place called Il Convento in Tuscany, and we ran a series of, I think there were 6 or 7 week retreats there every autumn from 1998 to 2004. So again, it was wonderful to be on retreat there and to feel, that sense of being somewhere else out of one's own, for me, out of our own country. But it was a lot of work to set that up and organise it. So it was both a challenge and an inspiration. So I guess the impact of Tiratanaloka on the Triratna community is that so many more women got ordained. I'm not very good at statistics. I don't have the statistics. Somebody will know how many women have got ordained since we founded Tiratanaloka, and it will be many, many, many women. And that's fantastic. And that really fulfills Sangharakshita's vision to create an order of people who are going to be of benefit to the world. So my involvement with Tiratanaloka spanned 15 years initially, so from that first retreat in 1990 until I left Tiratanaloka in 2005. And then my involvement continued because I became president of the centre. Each of our centres, city centre or retreat centres, has a president, someone who looks out for the team, looks out for the project. So I visited regularly the teams and, you know, met with the people, hung out with them, did some study with them. And sort of visiting over those years as their president, which I stopped doing in 2017, I was very inspired by the teams that followed my own team and by the team that's there now. And there's something very, very encouraging about, in a way, it's a bit like handing on a baton, isn't it? You hand on the baton of a project that's, you found that it's being very, very close to your own heart. And then your experience is that it's being run, managed even more effectively and creatively than you could have imagined. So very, very inspiring to have been in that role with those people. So yeah, I've been involved. I was involved with Tiratanaloka for a long time. And I loved living there. It was a beautiful place to live. I loved my time at Tiratanaloka. So it is quite hard to accept that we need to move on, that we have to sort of let that building go. Yes, it's kind of, you know, touches one's heart, as it were. And I haven't been there for 2 or 3 years, partly because of my own health and partly because of the pandemic. But because I've been involved with that project for so long, I can see Tiratanaloka in my mind's eye very, very clearly. I can see the buildings, the shrine room, I can see the stupa in the garden. I remember Bante coming to dedicate that stupa. I can see the old oak tree down by the stream. I can see the little bridge across the stream. I can imagine looking out over the reservoir, which is just down the road, and seeing the mountains in the distance. So yeah, I have so many memories of living there, being part of that project on so many different levels. So it's a project that means a great deal to me. But the inspiration for Tiratanaloka was always to fulfill Bhante's vision of allowing people to deepen their practice and enter our order and be of benefit to the world. So of course, I totally support Tiratanaloka Unlimited as a project, fundraising to find a beautiful new place, a bigger place, a place that can have a much bigger team to support it, both a support team and an ordination training team, a place that's going to allow as many women as possible to go on as many retreats as possible to deepen their practice. And I can see that not quite so clearly yet in my mind's eye. I can imagine that place. It exists somewhere. It will come into being. We will find it. And I hope we can all work together to make that into a reality.
Thank you very, very much indeed, Dhammadinna. Thank you on behalf of us all. Just so much vision in what you told us, vision right from the beginning and vision right up until now. And again, just wonderful to hear the history actually and have that sort of told about and listened to by all of us and recorded actually for years to come. So thank you very, very much indeed. So what we're going to do now, everyone, is we're going to just have a little 5 minute comfort break. So it's just coming up to 1:30, so just till 1:55. And then we're going to hear from two more shorter talks, two more 10 minute talks about people's experience of going to Tiratanaloka. And then we're going to finish with something else, yeah? So yeah, so gosh, it feels like we've had such a rich afternoon already, and there's even more to come. So now, having heard just this wonderful sort of panoramic history, really, we're now going to hear from two women, their experience of being ordained and their experience of asking for ordination and sort of a little bit more. And I think that's very, very good to have, just to have real people, as it were. you can talk in abstract terms about Buddhism, the Dharma and so on, but actually in the end, what you've got is people practicing. And so we're going to really now hear the stories of two people, one at a time, about their own journey. And now our next and last speaker is Beth. And Beth is someone who's just very recently asked for ordination. So I'm really looking forward to hearing from Beth to just talk to us about that, like why she's done that and what her experience of going on her very first ordination training retreat was like. So let's welcome Beth.
Thanks. Can everyone hear okay? Yeah. It's been really interesting today to hear a bit more about the women's retreat centres, Taraloka and Tiratanaloka, because I've been to both of those places and had a really, really meaningful time at both of those places. I was in Taraloka for my last retreat last month, actually, and I went to Tiratanaloka for the first time in January, and they've both been really special, important places to me. And it's actually made me feel really grateful that I can access retreats and that people have put in that hard work to get to this stage where it's so easy and so few barriers for women to go on retreats. When you go on the website, there's just so many options to choose from, which is amazing. So when Kara and Atara asked me to do this talk, my initial reaction was no. But then she gave me a bit of gentle prodding and enthusiasm and encouragement. And that did make me reflect and realize that the reason I had said no was due to fear. And overcoming fear has been a huge part of my journey so far and will continue to be. So I am quite nervous right now. But yeah, I just wanted to talk a bit about how Buddhism has changed my life, really, and the part that retreats have played in that. So I think from early on in life, I noticed suffering and dissatisfaction. And that was in myself and in other people. And I always felt a strong sense of compassion for others who were struggling with mental health or just various difficulties. And I engaged with volunteering quite early on in life and found that really helped me to connect to other people and help other people to feel seen and understood and valued. So I first came to Manchester Buddhist Centre as part of a teacher training event when I was doing a postgraduate teaching qualification. And that was in November 2019. So it wasn't actually my choice. And I don't remember much about that day. So that wasn't kind of the significant moment, but it definitely planted a seed, and something that day must have really interested me. Because then during the lockdown, I started to explore Buddhism at home online. And I did some online courses and eventually connected with Manchester Buddhist Centre. And I went to some Tools for Living Your Life classes, which were a really friendly, informal kind of sessions. And my first impression was just how welcoming and friendly everybody was at the sessions. Even though it was the first time I'd ever come along, people were just so interested and curious about each other. And in the breakout rooms, people would really share quite a lot of personal details and be quite vulnerable and open about themselves, which really inspired me and allowed me to do the same. So I think I immediately felt that connection. I also saw qualities that I admired embodied in other people, and that was really important to help me to see what I wanted to become and gave me a path to try and do that. So my first retreat was in August 2021 after the lockdown, and it was at Adastana, and it was an outdoor festival retreat. So I was camping and we were eating all our meals outside, and I just really felt such a sense of aliveness on that retreat in completely different conditions to my everyday life, which felt quite busy and stressful. I really enjoyed the periods of silence, and I felt like I was becoming part of something much bigger than myself, and it really was quite exciting. And I think that first retreat helped me to gain momentum when I came back to the center and start seeing myself a bit more seriously as an actual Buddhist practitioner. Having more confidence in myself. Soon after that, I became a mitra, and I also became a facilitator for the young Buddhist sessions, so helping to run sessions for younger people, which felt like quite a responsibility in a very positive sense. Leading and co-leading sessions has been a really big part of my practice, helping other people to engage with the teachings and to create a community together has been really important, and I think will continue to be for me. Since then, I've developed some strong spiritual friendships, and I've joined a study group, and I've noticed quite a lot of differences in myself in terms of my confidence interacting with people, the anxiety that I feel, and the kind of distinction between myself and other people that I experience. And I did quit the teaching job because I just noticed it was having such an impact on my mental health and my level of stress that it wasn't worth it for me personally. So now I've changed roles, and I'm helping young people with their mental health in schools on more of a one-to-one basis, which feels a lot more suited to me. And I really don't think I would have had the confidence to do that without having a spiritual community and without having the teachings to give me a kind of framework to navigate my life by. So last month I asked for ordination, and I had been thinking about it for a little while, and it was quite encouraging seeing some of my friends ask for ordination around the same time. Actually, I think that gave me a bit of a push to start thinking about it, and it seemed a bit more of a tangible thing that I could actually do. So it was in the back of my mind, and I decided to go on a weekend retreat at Tiratanaloka with a few other people in this room, actually. So we drove down together from Manchester. There were four of us that went there, and it was a weekend for people considering ordination, like considering asking for ordination, or some people who had already asked for ordination. So that was a really inspiring retreat. As soon as I got there, I felt so welcomed by the people who were leading the retreat, which were Vajratara and Karuna D. And they immediately showed us round to the whole beautiful retreat centre and allowed us to choose which room we wanted to stay in, and just really made us feel comfortable and at home straight away. It felt like a very personal touch, and like they were taking an interest in us. So the theme for this retreat was about how Buddhism and your spiritual journey can fit into the rest of your life. And a lot of references were made to the order as being a kind of fourth sight for other people, in terms of the Buddha's four sights that he saw. So he saw, I'm going to say them wrong now, is it old, age, sickness and death? And then the fourth one was a holy person. And that was the kind of inspiring sight that helped him to see that things could be different and what he could become. So I really liked that as a way of thinking as the order to inspire other people. Yeah, so I feel really proud to be a Buddhist and to be practicing within Triratna. And I'm very happy that women have got an equal ordination process, and that all of the hard work's been done to set up the centres for me to go and do all of these retreats. So yeah, I want to use my energy and enthusiasm to help other people to become interested in the Dharma and the teachings, and continue on my own journey. So I've got a poem to end on, and it's called Four Gifts by Sangharakshita. Before I start, I'll just mention a bit about the symbolism which inspired me from this poem. So the first gift is a lotus flower, which represents the process of spiritual development, a gradual unfolding of your potential. The second one is a golden net, and this represents the interconnectedness of the teachings of the Dharma and a vision of existence. And the golden nature of it symbolizes how precious and special it is. The third one is a shepherd's round dance. So this is something to do with, it represents the order, and it's something about dancing being something enjoyable and something done in a group and joyful. And the final one is a garden planted in the wilderness. So the garden is the spiritual community planted in the world, which is the wilderness. So cultivating something beautiful and inspiring where the lotus flowers can blossom. And also the invitation to be an active participant in this garden, to be a gardener and help out with building this community. So I'll finish on the poem. Four Gifts by Sangharakshita. I come to you with four gifts. The first gift is a lotus flower. Do you understand? My second gift is a golden net. Can you recognize it? My third gift is a shepherd's round dance. Do your feet know how to dance? My fourth gift is a garden planted in a wilderness. Could you work there? I come to you with four gifts. Dare you accept them?
Oh, thank you very, very much indeed, Beth. A really, really wonderful, wonderful talk. And I was really, really struck by your own sort of precept to yourself, actually, of not letting fear stop you doing things. And I think that's just brilliant. Brilliant thing to apply. And then you've given us a gift by giving us that talk. Thank you so much. Thank you. So we've had four wonderful speakers. It really has been so rich. I feel like I can't even remember when this afternoon started. It feels like a whole journey, because in a way it started, you know, where did it start? With the founding of Taraloka, or did it start Banti Sangharakshita realizing that, you know, the ordination for women had died out, and his whole being realizing there was something not right about that, you know. So it feels like we've sort of gone back in time and then right up into the present moment. So the final part of the afternoon is it's an opportunity us all to help, to really help, to be those gardeners, actually, to help to plant that garden in the wilderness of this world that so needs that. So just thinking, you know, listening to Beth just talking there, just thinking, well, there's hundreds of women like Beth, hundreds of women like so many people who want to really give their lives as a gift, actually, which I think Beth and others have expressed. And this is our chance to help that to happen more. Because as Dhammadinna said in her talk, after all that searching for Tiratanaloka, the ordination training center, even from the beginning, there was this feeling of, oh, it's on the small side. And now we definitely know it's too small. It's too small. A bit nearer. Okay, is it rattling?
Yeah.
Am I rattling? So it's, thank you. Yes, can you hear me all right? So Tiratanaloka is too small. We've created this project called Tiratanaloka Unlimited. And what Tiratanaloka Unlimited means is we just want to take the brakes off the inspiration and the aspirations of women like Beth, like Nishala Shri, like all of us, who want to transform ourselves, you know, who want to go beyond fear and other limitations, and who want to transform the world, who look out and see sort of the wilderness of the world and think, oh, let's create a garden here. Let's create something beautiful that other people can partake in and themselves can grow and be transformed. So we need a bigger retreat center to help to make that happen. And what we need for that retreat center, the main thing we need is basically money, because we've got all the other things. We've got an amazing team. I now live with the team and they are amazing. We've got this amazing inspiration of all these women who really want to sort of throw themselves into this project of creating that garden in the wilderness. In a way, we've got the difficult things. I just keep thinking, gosh, are we going to let a little bit of money stop us, you know, when we've got the difficult things? I mean, I say a little bit, but it's actually £1.5 million, which might sound like a lot. Well, it is quite a lot as well. But in another sense, you know, I'd rather have inspiration than be fundraising for the money than have the money and be fundraising for the inspiration, if you see what I mean. It's quite a good way round. So we're fundraising for the money to allow the inspiration just to be able to flow, so that when Beth thinks, oh, that was great at Tiratanaloka, I'd like to go on another retreat really soon, and then looks on the thing and it just says retreat full, retreat full, retreat full, you know, for about a year, you know. We don't want that to happen. We want Beth to be able to say, oh yeah, I want to go back next month. And we can say, oh yeah, come and bring all your friends and so on. So we need £1.5 million to fundraise for that. We need more than that, but we need to fundraise for that bit. But anyway, the brilliant news is we've already got £500,000 through fundraising. And actually, I'm delighted to say But in this very room, perhaps I won't say her name. No, I will say her name. Can I say your name? So I've got, we've got someone, we've got the person, Suri Shrata, got other people's names to say, who gave us our very, very first donation for Tiratanaloka Unlimited. Yay! Before, maybe she's gone now.
She was here earlier.
She was here earlier. She's gone. She gave us our very first. I remember that moment. I remember the mixture of joy, a bit like when the first £20 for the existing Tiratanaloka was received. And also that feeling, oh, there's no going back now. There's no going back now. This money's been pledged. And it was a lot more than £20 was pledged. So we've got people in this room who have already given us money and are fundraising for us. We've got, well, Dayanandi did a whole sponsored project to raise £1,000 and actually got £1,400, didn't you? Your sponsored art project. Moksha Siri is about to embark on an amazingly ambitious walking, massive sponsored walk with friends to raise more money. There's going to be an art sale coming up. Sina Devi gave all her 40th birthday money to us. That was amazing. So what I'm asking all of you here in this room, all of you on Zoom, all of you on retreat in Germany, is can you give us some money, please? When we launched this project on the Order Convention, we asked every Order member if they could consider giving us £5,000. At the end of our retreats at Tiratanaloka, we ask everybody if they can consider giving us £1,000. Here, I thought, what about if everybody could just give £100? Or $100, or 100 euros, or 100 anything. So of course, if you can give more, please do. You might pledge some money. I mean, it's amazing what people have found they could raise. You know, Diane Andy going over her target, the brilliant idea of seeing the Davy pledging her birthday money. So if you can give more, that would be great as well. So don't limit yourself to £100, dollars, euros, but if you can give more, that would be absolutely great, or whatever at all you can give, yeah? So you've all got on your chairs, those people in this room have got a card that I'll just show the people on screen as well, that looks like this. And if you turn it over, you can see that you can write how much you want to give on the bottom half, and then the top half you just keep for yourself, and then you've got a nice picture of happy ordained women to inspire you to know that that's what you've done. And then on your way out, there's going to be a golden bowl held by Lisa that you can put your filled pledge card in. And if you're watching on Zoom, we're going to put the link, yeah, the link's up there, so you can copy and paste that link, or the best thing is you can just go onto our giving page just now. Or if you're on retreat in Germany, perhaps, you can think, because you won't be going online, of course, because you're on retreat, you can think of an amount you want to give, and then write that down on a piece of paper and ensure one of your retreat leaders, such as Jai Lalita, will be happy to collect that up for you. So that's an option for everyone. And while we're doing that, what we're going to do is we're going to chant a mantra together. And we're going to chant the mantra of Avalokiteshvara, Om Mani Padme Hung. And Avalokiteshvara is a symbol for our order with his thousand arms, which are a symbol of actually being that gardener everywhere, you know, thousand arms, 11 heads to see the need and respond to it. Because of course, ordination isn't for ourselves only. It's to be a force for good in the world. That's really what's fired all this inspiration, you know, what's made, you know, Diane Andy live for off-ground sunflower seeds, you know, what's enabled Dhammadinna to drive around in that little car phoning from phone boxes, probably also eating ground sunflower seeds with the occasional cut price treat from Tesco's, you know. what's made all that happen, what's made all of us there at Tiratanaloka now, you know, work even harder to try and get somewhere that can be big enough so that no, we don't have to say no to anyone. At the moment, we're saying no to people, and it's heartbreaking. So we can do that. So that's what that mantra represents. So Dayanandi is going to start us in that mantra. We'll just chant that, have time to write on our pledge cards. You can write a message of support on the card as well. Time for people on Zoom to fill in the giving link. Time for people on retreat to maybe find a little bit of paper and write down how much you might like to give. Good. So when Dayanandi is ready, we'll have the mantra. And then when the mantra fades away, we'll just have a few concluding words from Karu Natara.
Well, I've got the really lovely job of saying thank you to everybody for an absolutely magical afternoon. It's just been wonderful. And so I just wanted to thank all of our fantastic speakers. We've been on such a journey. Like you say, we really have traversed these 55, 56 years, I'm never quite sure what it is, of the order, starting with that very first ordination of a woman by Sangharakshita. All the way to Beth asking for ordination last month. So that's just lovely. That just feels like such a fantastic arc to celebrate International Women's Day. So I really, really want to thank everybody. So Dayanandi for taking us to Taraloka, and we'll all really appreciate it much more next time we go. So thank you to Dayanandi. And thank you very much to Dharmadinna online. I don't know whether I should say this, but she's very generously spoken to us today. It's actually her birthday today. Aww. So happy birthday to Dhammadinna. And then I found really incredible two personal stories from Nishala Shri and Beth. And Nishala Shri has come in and she's gone already. Surya Shraddha's actually been looking after her daughter. So, you know, she's looking after her daughter today. But so I found it at the time. I was in a GFR group with Nishala Shri. So I supported her on that journey. It's just so moving and creative that the team allowed her to be ordained at that time. And then just Beth's amazing talk was just fantastic, moving and finishing with that beautiful poem. And last but not least, I would really like to thank Subhadramati. It's just been a joy to have you here this not even 24 hours, actually, nearly 24 hours. We've been hanging out together. It's been, Surya Shraddha's just joining us. Fantastic. She's fantastic. Thanks, Risha. So it's been a real joy to have Subhadramati here. The Sangha has really, really enjoyed her presence. And you've just held it so beautifully and so enthusiastically. And you're doing such an amazing job at encouraging us all and fundraising and inspiring us to be the best we can be. Particularly, I love the rain cloud and the idea of the rain falling on us all. So we just bought you some very small flowers because I know that Subhadramati is heading back for the train now. She's going back to her country residence for the next couple of weeks before she heads off for a three-month ordination retreat. So a very big round of applause for everybody. So thank you to everyone here in Manchester, and thank you to everybody online. I don't know, I think we got 70 or 80 people at the tops, and also fantastic that the German retreat centre was here with us beaming in. So that's maybe 100 people online. So that's just wonderful. And thank you very much for the amazing job that the translators did. I'm sure I spoke too fast. I speak too fast all the time. So thank you very much for all the hard work enabling lots of other people to join us today. And also thank you for our Wizzo Tech, both Buddhist Centre Online and also here in the room, Harriet and Sangadara. So thank you everybody for enabling. It's a team effort as ever. So thank you. And if you wouldn't mind as you leave, I think Lisa's going to be standing outside with the golden bowl. And you can leave your pledge cards there. So thanks everybody and go well. Okay.